In this video, we will use tyFlow to create interesting animations in 3ds Max and VRay. For this, we will first build a particle setup to destroy and reform our geometry, then generate splines to add dynamic trails, and finally build all the required shaders for the final effect. So in this video here, we're gonna be discussing on how to build this nice little animation that you can see in here. And while the result might look quite complex on first sight, it's actually quite simple to achieve something like this. And we're gonna be using tyFlow and VRay for 3ds Max in order to achieve this result. As usual, you can always find all of my scene files for all of my tutorials over on my Patreon, together with a whole course on car rendering and a lot of other additional goodies. So you can check this out if that's interesting for you. But other than that, let's just jump right in and see how this here is being built. So before we start to build the animation, let's quickly break down the individual parts so that you can understand what kind of elements we have to build. Let's first focus here on these parts, and you can see we have these small individual trails here on these kind of metal plates which fly away from our torus, and I can hide them for now. So this would be one element, these small trails, and then we have these small metal plates here which form our torus. So let me also hide this one in here. And those two parts will be the things which we gonna be using tyFlow for. And then we have here this cage, so I can also hide the cage. And then this here is just the remaining inside of our torus. So now if I unhide all of those different parts here together, you can see we will get the final result. And this is what we're gonna be building now in this tutorial in here. So right here you can see my starting position, and this here is just a simple polygon geometry. You can see we have these small hexagon shapes here which form our torus, and now we're gonna be using this empty tyFlow object in here to generate particles, and then we're gonna animate them. So for this, let's add this simple birth objects operator. And then also enable this hide after adding option here, so that once I select my geometry, it automatically gets hidden because it's converted to a particle now in this tyFlow object. So now it's basically in here in this tyFlow object. And now we're gonna be adding a display data. In order to understand what's happening, you can see we have this ID 0 here at the center. That means that the whole thing here is treated as one particle. That's of course not what we want. We want to basically split them up in small individual pieces. So for this, let's add here the face fracture operator in front. And then once I do this and I go into the display data and also increase here the max particles to, for example, 10,000, you can see that now each of those small hexagons here is basically a own particle. And now we can also show here the transformation axis and scale that a little bit higher. And you can see that now we have an issue, and that is that all the normals of each of those little particles here are facing in the same direction. That's not really what we want, because if we want to push them out from the center, they basically have to follow the normal direction. Let me just disable this one in here so we can see that better. And for this, let's add a simple rotate operator in here. And there is the option to only rotate the pivot. So you can see at the moment, all of those here are randomly rotated. Let's disable this option here, and then only the pivot here will be rotated. And now we just need to find a way to basically align the pivot here back to the original surface normals. And for this, let's use the surface align mode in here, and then also pick the original geometry in here. And then once we did this, you can see that now all of the normals here are facing in the appropriate direction. So now, after having confirmed that everything is correct, we can disable our display data. Then let's go to this display operator and then disable here this display material option, so that we can always see the color that's selected in here. And that's also much easier to understand than at what point it will jump into a new event. And that's exactly what we're gonna do now. So let's add a simple time test. And then let's put, for example, here a variation of 0 and the value of 10. And then jump into a new event. And for this, let's use here a simple, let's say, speed operator. Also in the display tab, disable the display material option again, and then connect this one into here. And now we will go through, and you can see that at frame 10, basically all of those particles are moved to the new event. And then we have some random speed that's applied in there. So now let's change, for example, the magnitude here to a higher value. And then instead of random 3D, let's use the particle Z direction. So that means that basically the particles are now being pushed along the normals. And let's put a maximum variation of 100% so that it's not all looks like it's going at the same time. You can see that already looks quite interesting. We can add, for example, here a spin so that these particles here will also spin around. And then we can also use a simple force with, for example, here a curl turbulence. And then let's add, for example, a strength of 0.3, frequency of 0.5, and scale of 0.1. And now you can see that those really go crazy. I think at the moment it's a little bit too much. So let's add a slow operator to just make sure that those also will slow down again. And yeah, they still go quite crazy. So now the important thing is, how can we make them move back to the original position? Because at the moment they just basically keep on flying around, and that's not really what we want. We want that at a certain stage they return to the original position, and let's check that now. So for this, we first would have to store our original position of our particles from the first event. So let's go back to our first event and let's put a custom properties operator in here. And it has two options. One is to set a value, one is to get a value. So in this case, we want to set a value, and then we have to decide whatever we want to store in here. Let's store the entire TM, that stands for transformation matrix, and then also give it a name, for example, original position. So that's just a simple name that we gave it so that we can find the data that's stored in here later on. And now we will just duplicate here our custom properties. In this case, we will switch here the mode to get. And let's also put a display operator in here so that we can see what's happening. Let's change the color to red, for example. And let's add a time test and give it a value of 10, for example, and then connect this into our new event. So now let's see what's happening. So we're starting here, and then after 10 frames, we jump here into our second event where those particles are being pushed out. And then after 10 more frames, we jump to our third event. And you can see that by the color change, now we're in this event in here, and those particles are still being pushed out, but they initially jump back here to the original position. So first we would have to stop this like moving out again. So for this, let's add here a stop operator where we stop all the velocity and spinning and so on. And now it's more easy to understand what's happening. So the particles here jump back after 10 frames to its original position. So while this is nice, we don't want that they jump back here abruptly. We want that they find the target again. For this, we have to add a new event in between here. So let's add a new event for that. And inside here, we need to add a find target operator. And then we have to link the time test into this new event. And then as the find target, we want to define here the mode to custom transformation matrix. Here also use our original position, which we saved out earlier. We can also do the same thing here for the target alignment, and then move this event here into our event that we built earlier. So it looks like this. And now what's happening is that basically we have those particles here moving back, and then they slowly basically rebuild our original shape again. So now let's use here slightly different settings. For example, we can use the value here of 2 so that this here goes a little bit faster and we don't have this very long transition. Whatever value you put in here, the higher it goes, the faster basically the condition here is fulfilled and the faster here we go back to our original position. We can also use the ease in here, for example, with a value of 50%. So those particles are easing in a little bit. And I think like this, it looks already quite nice. So now basically we control everything through simple time tests in here. But our original example had that we had this effect here moving in a circular fashion. So it's starting here and then just moving around our torus. And for this, I have a very simple geometry here prepared, which is just this simple sphere with some noise animation. And this one basically just like rotates around here our circle. And now we want to use this in order to trigger this effect. So everything is started by here our original time test. So it means that after 10 frames, we start to trigger this animation. So let's disable this. Then basically we only in this event. And now we need to use a different condition for this. We're gonna use a surface test instead of a time test. And we're gonna pick here this sphere. And then we're gonna choose here the volume inside. And once we link this to our second event, and let's hide our sphere, then we can see that now basically the sphere here defines where these particles are being pushed outwards basically. And we have here this part of the animation already finished. So now if we look at our finished result, we have these small metal plates that are basically animating around. This we already finished now. And now the next step is that each of those little metal plates here has this kind of like interesting trail, which is following them. And that's the part which we're gonna now be discussing in the next step. So in order for that to work, we have to generate new particles once we enter here our second event. So once those here turn to this greenish color, they have to trace some trail of new particles behind them. And for this, we can use the spawn operator. So let me just add this here into our flow. And then I want to change the display to dots, for example. And now we can put the spawn operator here in our second event, because that's when we want to trigger this spawn event and then link this into our new event. So once we do this, you can see that now we have these new particles which are generated as soon as we enter here this second event. And at the moment, they just float around without like any kind of shape that we want. So we have to change that. We have to go here and change this to travel distance. So they're basically following the original particles here based on their travel distance. And we don't want to inherit any velocity. So let's put the inherit velocity to 0. And then once we do this, you can see that now here we have these kind of trails which are following our particles. You can see that at one point they seem to stop. And that's exactly when we move into this event in here. So what we can do is that we just copy here this spawn operator and then also paste this inside as an instance, move this down to here, and then connect this also into this event in here. And now you can see that this trail of particles doesn't stop. It's basically following the whole motion of our metal plates, and that's actually what we want. So now we have the issue that they are not really disappearing. They always stay there. For this, we can easily add here a delete operator and then choose based on the, for example, particle age of like 10 frames. And that means that after 10 frames, we will delete those particles. So now we have more the appearance of these kind of trails which are following our metal plates. So that's exactly what we want. Now the only thing we have to do is to link these individual particles here together and then add some additional noise modifier or something on top so that it doesn't look so boring like a straight line. And it looks like a little trail that's following these kind of small metal plates in here. So for this, let's first reduce here the amount of particles, because I think at the moment it's a little bit too many. So we can go in the spawn operator and then choose the step size, for example, to something like 2 centimeters. Once we do this, you can see that now these dots are further apart. It's basically the resolution of our splines in here. So let's choose something like 2.5 so that we still have the appearance of splines, but we don't dealing with so many particles in here. And now we can add a particle bind operator. Once we do this, a lot of stuff changes. So let's first go in here and show our bindings. And once we have this, then we can switch this here to bind siblings. And then also this one here to bind siblings. And now you can see we have these kind of like lines here, which are connecting our particles. So you can see they are all bound here in this one line and they are attached together. And what this enables us now to do is that we can add some kind of force operator here on top in order to just have some random motion in there. So let's add a force and then switch this here to curl, for example, with a strength of 0.1. And now you can see these lines here, they changed a little bit. Let's make, for example, 0.5 to have a stronger effect. And you can see that now those lines here, they are moved a little bit and they are not so boringly straight anymore. I think this one is a bit too strong. So let's put a value of 0.2, for example. And we have the kind of appearance that those lines here are following our metal plates, and there's even some kind of dynamics to them. So they're influenced by the wind or whatever is happening in here. And I think like this, it should be quite good. So now we can disable here to visualize our bindings. So let's not show the bindings anymore. And then we can add a simple spline path modifier in here. And then let's create a new tyFlow spline object. And then switch this one here to siblings. And now we generate basically splines, which are exactly here our particle trails. So like this here, our whole tyFlow setup is basically finished already. And now the only thing we have to do is to make some nice shaders to blend everything here nicely together. And that's what we're going to be doing in the last and final step. So now if we actually start the rendering, we don't really see anything yet. And that is because we have to first convert here our tyFlow into a mesh. We also need to mesh out these splines that we built in here. So for this, you can easily just add a mesh operator here. And then this one also would need to be copied in all of the other parts in here. And also this one. This one we don't need because this one is just the spline part. And now if we start rendering again, you will see that now we have here our geometry showing up in the render view. So now rather than building all of those shaders here from scratch, let's just go briefly through the most important parts. And as I said, there's a lot of tutorials in my channel already that describes how to build some nice materials. So you can check this out. And the first thing I want to do is to give them here some thickness, because at the moment they don't really have a thickness. It's just some single-sided polygons basically. So for this, let's give them here an outer amount of 0 and an inner amount of, let's say, 0.5. And like this here, our plates, they have a slight amount of thickness in there. And in order to bring out the details here nicer, let's enable this bump map. And this bump map here basically just has this nice handy V-Ray edges texture, which basically gives the appearance that this edge here is slightly beveled. And like this, I think you can get a much nicer result on those plates in here. Then another important thing that I did was to basically randomize here the colors for each of those individual plates. And this you can easily do with a V-Ray multi-subtexture. I just put this here to by element, and I have a random gamma here of 5%. If I increase this, for example, to 50, you can see the difference here becomes much stronger. And I just have these three slightly different colors in here, so that we have some plates which are slightly more greenish, some are slightly more bluish, and so on. And overall, it gives, I think, quite a nice appearance. And then I have also some kind of roughness here in the glossiness parameter, so it just breaks up the specular a little bit. So now in this next step, let me unhide here the cage. That's just some simple geometry that basically frames here all of our metal plates. And now I want to build the effect that basically where those plates are separating, there's a very strong glow happening. And this is very easily done. So remember, we had here our original sphere that was used to push out those particles in here. And we can just take the same sphere, duplicate it, and hide this one. Just give it a different color. And now we can add, for example, a slice modifier, and then rotate this one here 90 degrees. And then also remove the top and maybe move it slightly down so that we basically only have the front side here of our sphere and not the back side anymore. So now in the shader for the cage, I already added a V-Ray distance texture here in the self illumination, and I gave it some black and greenish color. And now we only have to pick our sphere in here. And now you can see that the part here is masked off and we have this very strong glow. The slice was added just that I don't have the same thing here on the backside. This can also be a nice effect. But in this case, since we have this clockwise movement, I only want to have this glow here at the front. And that's why I added this additional slice here. So now let me unhide here the inside of my torus. And that's just this very simple geometry with some self-illumination material. But with all of the other details here, it looks quite complex and blends nicely together. And now the last step would be that we have to make these splines here renderable, because at the moment they don't really render. For this, we have to add a ty spline measure modifier. Then once we did this, we have to restart the rendering. And now you can see that those splines here are rendering. So let me do some modifications to that. We can add some tapering here to make them like thinner towards the end. And I want to have a slightly smaller radius, for example, 0.25 centimeters in this case. And I think like this for the geometry, I like it. So now let's add some material to them. And for this, I just added this very simple V-Ray self-illumination material. And once that's rendered, you can see how the result looks like. And as you can see, the material is very simple. We just have this greenish color. We multiply the color by the opacity. And then inside here, we have a simple opacity ramp that basically fades it out towards the end. And here at the tip, we have this kind of hotspot. So now having rendered everything out, you can see the finished result in here. And considering how easy it was to set all of this up, I think it looks actually quite nice and quite detailed. As usual, you can find always my scene files on my Patreon, together with a whole course on car rendering and lots of other additional goodies. So check out this if that's interesting for you. Otherwise, see you in the next tutorial. Take care and see you soon.